Father, I ask you to show us the power, the forgiveness factor. Pour your Holy Spirit down. Open our eyes, our hearts, our minds, that we can be a living, powerful witness to this nation at this time. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Few people realize the power of forgiveness. Recently, it was demonstrated when Brant Jean looked over at the judge and requested permission to go and hug the one that had killed his brother. The judge consented. Darren Simon reported the following on CNN. The jury had just sentenced former Dallas police officer Amber Geyer to 10 years in prison. I don't know if this is possible, but can I give her a hug, please? He asked. Yes, District Judge Tammy Kemp said. Jean stepped down from the witness stand and hugged Geyer tightly. He said, I don't want to say it twice or for the 100th time, what you or how much you've taken from us. I think you know this, he said. But if you truly are sorry, I know I can speak for myself. I forgive you, he told Geyer. And I know if you go to God and ask him, he'll forgive you. He said, I love you, he said, and I just like anyone else. But I'm not going to say, I hope you rot and die just like my brother did. I personally want the best for you. His testimony was so powerful that it even touched the judge's heart. And she went over and gave this woman a hug and gave her Bible. It turned into quite a controversial event. It just didn't seem reasonable, but yet it was freeing. Few people realize the freedom that's involved in forgiveness. Nadine Collier also brought healing about when she shared the forgiveness factor. This was some years back at Emmanuel African Methodist Church in Charleston, South Carolina, where a racist went into the church and shot down so many innocent people. Nadine's words, you took something very precious from me, but I forgive you, words of reconciliation that vibrated throughout the community and spoke a loud, clear message of the power of forgiveness. Each and every one of us have had tragedies in our life, perhaps not to that extent, but it may be someone very close to us, turning on us, saying things that were very hurtful, or maybe someone we've met, someone we've worked with. And it's so easy to hold that in our heart and be bound like that for the rest of our life. These individuals, Nadine and Brant, knew what it was to experience the forgiveness factor and to let the power of God flow in them and through them. It's all over in the scriptures. We see that. Forgiveness not only frees another person, but it particularly frees you and I. Instead of holding bitterness in our heart and being imprisoned, we discover the joy that comes from forgiving. Jesus knew how powerful it was. And in the Lord's Prayer, he says, Father, forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against you. And he tells us that if we want God to forgive us, we've got to be willing to forgive other people. So right now, at this very moment, we need the power of the Holy Spirit and the grace of our risen Lord and Savior Jesus Christ to wash over us, to just wash away the bitterness, wash away the hostility, to wash away the resentment, the anger, enable us to be free in our spirits as we stand on the solid rock of our resurrected Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who bridged the gap between teaching all of this, who bridged the gap between creeds and deeds by hanging on that cross and said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. He's speaking of all those that hollered, crucify him, crucify him. He's speaking to his executioners that had executed him. And even a religious establishment, they're executing the Messiah, the very Son of God. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And at this particular moment, perhaps you find yourself all bound in bitterness, resentment, hatred. And yet, like waves lapping up against a shore, generation after generation of this bitterness can pass on from generation to generation to generation. That's how someone just engages in the forgiveness factor and begins to forgive. Unforgiveness can hold us in bondage. We see that forgiveness factor at work when we take a look at Genesis chapter 37 through 50. And there we encounter the life of Joseph. Now, perhaps as a child, and even growing up, you're familiar with Joseph and his multicolored robe and the jealousy of his brothers and how he's thrown into a pit by his brothers and actually want at one point kill him. Instead, they sold him into slavery. And Joseph goes into slavery, and he does the very best he can on his job there. And then he's accused by Potiphar's wife of rape, which he didn't do, and he's thrown into prison again. At that stage, it would have been so easy for Joseph just to have been overwhelmed by bitterness, hostility, and hatred. But he kept his spirit free so he could hear when God spoke to him, so he could interpret Pharaoh's dream. And if he'd been bound with all the thoughts of bitterness and getting even, what would have happened? He never would have been able to be used by God in such a great and mighty way. Forgiveness enables our spirit to be clear and to hear all the things that God wants to say to us at this particular time. And as a result of Joseph being able to experience the freedom of forgiveness, just allowing God's love to wash over his life and wash away that bitterness, standing on that solid rock of the Lord and his grace, Joseph was able to interpret Pharaoh's dream to him. And as a result, Joseph became second in command in the land of Egypt. And we read this, though, and this is what's so powerful and so traumatic, was that later when his brothers did come and bow down to him and he revealed himself, Joseph is able to tell them in Genesis chapter 50, verses 20 and 21, "You intended to harm me, but God intended for good to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. So then don't be afraid. I'll provide for you and your children." And he reassured them and spoke kindly to them. In Genesis 39:2, it says the Lord was with Joseph. The fact is, the Lord is also with you and me. And if we could, at this particular moment, just turn loose. I mean, get down on your knees. I had to do it last night. I said, "Lord, this person continues to say this and do that. And Lord, it'd be so easy to be so bitter against him, but I don't want any bitterness in my life. Jesus, let your love wash over me. Jesus, set me free that I can truly love that person at this particular moment. Lord, I'm asking you right now, in the name of Jesus, to just set me free that I can just forgive them. And as I forgive them, it's just like he comes and he cleanses me. He washes it away. And I have to do that. Often, from this situation to that situation, it's a desire to let his love and power just move in my life. Jesus has come to set us free from the plague of bitterness that locks into being victims of the past. And he frees us to receive the promises of the future. As we choose at this particular moment to release the past and forgive, we in turn allow God to take control of our lives and heal us of our emotions. Yes, he tells us in his word in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 32. He said, he shows us this motivation we have for forgiving others. Paul put it this way: "Be kind and compassionate," he says in Ephesians 4:32, "to one another, forgiving each other, just as Christ God forgave you." Forgiving each other, just as Christ forgave us. Earlier I mentioned the Lord's Prayer, Matthew chapter 6, verse 12, where Jesus says, forgive us our trespasses, we forgive those who trespass against us. If we live on this earth for any period of time, somebody's going to trespass against us. Somebody is going to invade the privateness of our heart. They're going to do something that we're going to be tempted to become very bitter, and we'll be tempted to even get even. But that spirit of revenge keeps us from experiencing the peace of God that passes all understanding, and actually hearing God, because he tells us, Jesus says, "My sheep hear my voice, they know me and they follow me." When the Lord shows us how to respond and how to continue to keep moving through life, if we're all bound up in bitterness and hostility, you know, we'll keep it all inside, and then suddenly we'll explode. And we'll take it out on this person, that person, that person. Pretty soon, there'll be less and less people we'll be able to get along with in life. And it's going to be a mighty lonely existence. So somewhere, somehow, we have to just stop. And we say, "Lord, on the seashore of life, I'm asking right now that your love will just sweep over me. I'm asking you to wash all the bitterness out of me, Lord. I'm standing on you, Jesus, the solid rock." As we choose to exercise the forgiveness factor, we're free from being victims of the past, and we become victors of the present. We can begin to live in the now, and our present is not dominated by things that hurt us in the past. We can become victors and not victims. More than conquerors, as the scripture says, through Christ Jesus who strengthens us. That's the forgiveness factor at work. Jesus has come to set us free. He's come to set us free from the tyranny of self, from the tyranny of bitterness, from the tyranny of hostility, enables us to be creative forces of good in a hurting world. That's the challenge that He gives us at this particular moment. And as we choose to experience the forgiveness factor in our lives, we can experience God's grace and allow it to move in us and through us. As Luke 23, 34 says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Think of the power of that. Jesus has been hung on a cross. He's there to die for the sins of humanity. And the very people that nailed Him to the cross are the ones that He's dying for. Wow, what love it took. And yes, Jesus taught the whole message of forgiveness. But then He's given that opportunity to express it as He's hanging on the cross. He bridges that gap between all the things He taught, all the creeds, and the direct deed of forgiving. And that's what we saw in Grant Jean. And when he exercised it, they're still talking about it. It even touched the judge's heart. We see that happening. And also what happened in Nadine Collier's life when she forgave. Yes, you and I are given those opportunities. And the greater the offense, the greater the power of the forgiveness. That one has hurt you over and over and over. That doesn't mean you just sit there and keep taking the hurt over and over and over. The Bible says to speak the truth in love. And for the offender's sake, you've got to say, what you've done has really hurt me. What you've done has really affected me. But I want you to know that I forgive you. And it just totally breaks the bondage of it all. To forgive also, as I indicated, means to speak that truth in love. And that's why Philippians 4:8 tells us this. It tells us as we go to the offender on a one-to-one basis and speak that truth in love, it says, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Think about such things. To let the light and love of Christ flow in us and through us. And so we think about those things. And so here's this person, they've offended us. Here's this person has done these things to us. It's easy for us just to focus on that. But there's got to be some good in them. So we think about the good that they've done. We think about what they've done that's right. We think about what they've done that is pure and lovely and admirable. And we start praying for them. And we really start praying for them. And the more we start praying for them, we start feeling more love for them. And we experience the power to forgive. Forgiveness. Oh, what a powerful thing it is. Matthew West is a powerful song about forgiveness that I'm going to share with you at this particular time. As we think about forgiveness, we also think about some of the very hideous, hurtful things that have been done in the past, in history, and what's being done at the present time. And we think about the need for forgiveness and how we need to forgive at this particular moment as we go forth in this world speaking the truth in love. The only way we're going to be set free, the only way we're going to get better as we get older rather than bitter, is if we let forgiveness begin to flow. Knowing this, though, is not just enough. We have to do it. And many choose to bury their anger, fearing it's going to become like a raging fire, burning out of control. Yet anger has to go somewhere. And as a result of it being buried in that individual, their daily life becomes an environment of a toxic waste, just being poured out in their life, and it begins to demonstrate itself in forms of depression, substance abuse, promiscuity, dreams of wild revenge, and so much more. That's why God's Word shows us there's a better way of handling it, and that is through genuine love and forgiveness. And without genuine love and forgiveness, you know, a family's torn apart, friendships torn apart, a church and its ministry is rendered unproductive, ineffective, if it's not torn apart. And that's why forgiveness is so very, very important. So the time has come for us to stop denying the hurt that's been done inside our lives and that which is ripping us up, and also blaming others for it. It involves starting all over and filtering that hurt and pain through the love of Jesus Christ and letting Him heal us. He says, come to me, all you who labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Every fabric of a relationship needs the binding of God's love. Such a binding involves taking that quantum leap, or like an electron that's just aimlessly circling the nucleus of resentment and bitterness, hostility. We receive a new burst of energy when we suddenly find ourselves thrust around the nucleus of God's love. And the spiritual quantum law results in the forgiveness factor, which is summed up in Galatians chapter 5, verses 14 and 15, where it says, the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command. Love your neighbor as yourself. If you bite and devour each other, watch out, they'll be destroyed by each other. Revolving around the nucleus of bitterness brings destruction. Receiving the energy of Christ's love and the cleansing that forgiveness provides through His death and through His resurrection results in life and liberty from the mistreatment of the past. It sets us free. It sets us free. Grant Jane didn't want to go through his whole life being very bitter at this police officer that entered his brother's apartment and shot him. So he did it for his own sake. He let the person know how much they had hurt him, or she had hurt him, and at the same time, he forgave. Brought tears to the judge's eyes, said someone ridiculed the judge, but she got off the bench and went out, hugged that person also, and gave her a Bible. That's so revolutionary today. It's so abnormal today in a period in which there's a polarization of this party against that party and people hating and bittering and families being split up over politics and certain incidents. It's so tragic. Our country needs healing today. And so these individual acts of forgiveness serve as a loud, clear testimony to a nation that has forgotten the power of the Word of God and the power of forgiveness. As long as you hold on to your bitterness, you're going to be a victim of it. You're going to be a victim of that bitterness. Yes, you were deeply hurt in the past. But the fact is you can't change the past. What you can change is your response to it, your perception of it, your feelings of it, your willingness to lay it down before God. And that's why you need to start all over again in a positive way and respond to the invitation of Jesus when He says in Matthew 11:28, "Come to Me, all you who are weary and burdened, I will give you rest." When I let bitterness run in my life, I have no rest. So I have to just lay it down before Him. And I'm not able to experience the blessings of God if I let bitterness have control and imprison me. And neither will you. And He wants us to experience freedom in the depths of our soul. And that's why it's so critical we understand how to implement this message of forgiveness and just let it go. Just let go of this bitterness. Bitterness keeps us from seeing the wonders of God's beauty and creation all around us. Bitterness keeps us from experiencing God in the now as we keep captivated in the past. Bitterness fills us so full of self that there's no room for the love of God. And we're miserable human beings. So again, we need to get down before the Lord and just let His love just to sweep over us like an ocean wave and just wash away the bitterness, wash away the hostility. Because bitterness, it would drive us into a self-centered spirituality that doesn't include the needs of others. We won't care about people that are hurting and homeless out there. And that's why we have to daily allow God to drive bitterness and unforgiveness out of our lives. And as we spend time alone with Jesus and in His Word, the wonders of His creation, as we talk to Him in prayer, and let His peace that passes all understanding sweep over us. I believe that people grow old, includes all of us, not because of a hardening of just the arteries, but a hardening of the heart, which is a result of getting bitter rather than better. Time and hopelessness can wear us down on this journey of life. Yet I've learned that daily implementing the Word of God and letting the forgiveness factor flow, we can experience what the Word of God says, like 2 Corinthians, where it says, "We do not lose heart. Though outwardly we're wasting away, yet inwardly we're being renewed day by day." You don't have to be wasted away inwardly. Maybe outwardly, maybe things aren't as quite as easy as them in the past. You may feel like that. But inwardly we're getting renewed day by day. 2 Corinthians 4:16 in the Message Bible says, "We're not giving up. How can we? Even though on the outside it looks like things are falling apart, on the inside where God is making new life, not a day goes by without His unfolding grace." It's a reality. God's grace. It's a reality of the presence of Jesus Christ that breaks the hard shell of bitterness and gives us the power to forgive. By His emotional healing, yes, by the emotional healing that Jesus gives us, we can be set free from the bondage of the past. That's taken such a destructive toll. As we surrender to Christ, we get a better understanding of His love and power, and so we can get better as we get older rather than bitter. Now, let's quickly in the remaining moments take a deeper look at the forgiveness factor. by seeing how it can work in our life and allow emotional healing to take place. You see, emotional healing begins to take place when we let forgiveness flow as we follow Jesus, and we desire to become like Him. We desire to be more and more like Jesus. As this happens, begin to walk like Jesus walked. We're going to walk in love, as 1 John chapter 2, verse 6 says. We begin to love as Jesus loved. We see that in John 13, 34 to 35. We're able to pray as Jesus prayed. We see that in Matthew chapter 6, verses 9 to 15. We're able to forgive as He forgave, which Colossians 3, 13 says. Our complete emotional healing takes on His personality traits, His actions, and His reactions to events. Our lives are modeled after Jesus Christ. As He becomes the focal point of our emotions and actions, in order for this to happen, it's absolutely essential we pray and we study the Word of God and just let that Word get down deep inside of us. And the emotionally mature person in whom forgiveness is willing to suffer as Christ suffered, which Galatians chapter 6, verses 17 and 2 Corinthians 4:10 explains, begins to work in our lives, we begin to experience His peace, His power, His freedom that passes all understanding. We can't get any closer to Christ than to abide in His wounds and let our hurts be filled with His love. And then the more we become aware of the fact that we're sinners saved by grace, the more we appreciate the fact that Christ has removed the plague of sin from our lives and the forgiveness that Jesus has given to us. It takes us off that emotional roller coaster of up and down, anger, bitterness, hatred, and it allows us to enter into emotional healing and power and purpose that Christ promises and that He's given to each and every one of us. He said, yes, and that's why He said, come to Me, all you who labor, all of you who are stressed out, all of you who are weary, and I will give you rest. Your experience with the Lord doesn't have to be up, down, you can just be moving forward, fast, being effective and productive as you stay free at this time and move the obstacles, the bitterness, hatred, anxiety on the journey of life. It's a fact. You're no longer, this bitterness no longer has to define your future. You may have been hurt by parents or friends or strangers or relatives, but now you've been given opportunity through the grace of Jesus Christ to forgive them. It may seem like the hardest thing in the world right now, but Jesus has come to set you free. Right now, at this very moment, just surrender your life to Him. Say, Lord, on this journey of life, Lord, I don't want to keep running into the rocks and obstacles of bitterness and hostility, Lord God. I want the ways of Your love to flow over me right now, Lord. Wash away this bitterness, Lord. Wash away this hatred. Lord, I ask right now in the name of Jesus that You'd come and You'd fill me with Your power and Your presence and Your love. Set me free, Lord, that I can hear You as You speak to me in Your still small voice and through Your Word, and that I can follow You, Lord God. And Your love can flow in me and through me as You have set me free right now. In Jesus' name, I accept this the forgiveness that You've given me, Jesus, and I let it flow into the lives of those that have hurt me. Thank You for the forgiveness that You've given me. In Jesus' name, I ask this. I receive it. Amen.
As Reverend Larry Rice and the staff of NLEC ask Jesus Christ to strengthen them through the power of the Holy Spirit, you also can do the same. If you've never committed your life to Jesus Christ, you can do that now. Just ask Him to forgive you for all of your sins and to be your Lord and Savior.